Good afternoon. In today's class, we will be seeing the protocols that we have started earlier, that is the flow control and error control protocols of data link layer. So one of the functionality of or the functions that a data link layer is supposed to do is flow control and error control. Now for flow control and error control, the data link layer has a few protocols, and we have actually seen two of the protocols yesterday. And since these protocols are very important, I'll be revising them once again before we move on further. So in the yesterday's class, we have seen these protocols, which is the simplest and the stop and wait protocol. So we have seen the simplest protocol and stop and wait protocol. These, as I said earlier, were for noiseless channel, or we can even say that it is a ideal channel or a perfect channel or even error-free channel. That is, there is no error or there is no data lost in these channels. These are ideal, and they do not exist. These noiseless channels do not exist in the real world. So basically, to understand the noisy channel protocols, we have studied the noiseless channel protocol. Now, in yesterday's class, we have seen both of them, but once again, today we will revise both of them. The reason being, the next protocol, that is stop and wait ARQ, is based on this stop and wait protocol. So let's revise this one. So yesterday in the noiseless error-free channels, the first one was simplest protocol. So what is the simplest protocol? It is a unidirectional protocol in which data frames are traveling in only one direction from the sender to the receiver. And now, whenever the data frames are traveling, in the case of the simplest protocol, what happens is there is no acknowledgement, or the sender does not care about the receiver, whether the receiver is receiving the frames, discarding the frames, or any such thing. It will simply keep on sending the frames. So, as I said earlier in the yesterday's class, if you remember, this height of the frame is actually the time taken for the first bit to the last bit to travel. And this line, the dotted line, shows the time. And here, the sender's network layer gives a request to the data link layer that you have to transfer data. The data link layer will frame it, that is, it uses a framing concept, and that frame is then transferred to the receiver side, where the physical layer will notify the data link layer of the arrival. We have seen this diagram already in yesterday's class. So simply we will just revise it a bit. So these are the frames that are being sent, and we assume that the receiver can immediately handle any frame. That is, here in the simplest protocol, we are making an assumption that the receiver does not need processing time. So obviously, whenever a receiver receives data, it will need some kind of processing time, but here in this case, we are assuming that receiver does not need any processing time and it is negligible. That is why we are saying that this cannot exist in the ideal world. So similarly, we are sending frames in this way. So we are sending multiple frames and the frames are arriving at the receiver side. Now, the next thing is the protocols for the data link layer of the receiver immediately removes the header from the frame and hands the data packet to its network layer, which can accept the packet immediately. So in other words, basically, the receiver can never be overwhelmed with the incoming frames. So here the receiver does not have so many frames that it cannot process. So we are not considering the processing time in the simplest protocol case. Now, it is very simple. The sender sends a sequence of frames without even thinking about the receiver. To send four frames, four events occur at the sender side and four events occur at the receiver side. Now we will be seeing the next protocol, which was the stop and wait protocol. This is actually important to understand your stop and wait ARQ protocol. So for stop and wait ARQ protocol, you have to understand one thing. That is, it is the stop and wait protocol is a, as we have said, is a data link layer protocol. So first and foremost, it is a data link layer protocol. And why do we need this? For transmission of frames, obviously, when we are transmitting the frames. So this is our this is the work to be done, transmission of frames. Now, and is it unidirectional? As I said in yesterday's class, we will be studying all the protocols in unidirectional case because it will be easier to understand. Bidirectional will be a bit difficult. So it provides unidirectional data transmission with flow control facilities. One more thing to be understood here is, in the noiseless channel protocols, we are only dealing with flow control. We are not dealing with error control. Error control is not being dealt in the noiseless channel protocol. Noiseless channels protocol, that is simplest and stop and wait. In simplest, there is no flow control also, but in stop and wait, we have flow control, but we don't have error control. Now, what is the idea of stop and wait protocol? So basically, after sending one frame, so when a frame is sent, the sender will send the frame. Receiver, as soon as it receives the frame, it is supposed to send an acknowledgement. The receiver will send an acknowledgement that, yes, I have received the frame. Then only the sender can send another frame. So this is the basic idea of stop and wait protocol. So now let's see that if data frames arrive at the receiver site faster than they can be processed, the frames must be stored until their use. So if sender A is sending to a frame to receiver B, then what should happen is the receiver will need to store it if they're arriving faster than that. So in that case, what happens is the receiver does not have enough storage space, especially if it is receiving data from many sources. So this may result in as I said yesterday, two things will happen. One is the discarding of frames. The other is the denial of service. So either the frames will be discarded or the service, that is the sender will say that I cannot accept anything right now. So to prevent these two things to happen, to prevent the receiver from becoming overwhelmed or getting too many frames at the same time, we need to tell the sender to slow down. How can we tell that? Basically, there must be feedback from the receiver. The receiver should give feedback to the sender that, okay, I have received this frame, I have processed it, now you can send me another frame. So this feedback system is basically known as acknowledgement, and we use the word ACK. Okay, so now, this protocol that we have studied, or what the procedure that we have studied just now is called the stop and wait protocol. Because the sender sends one frame, stops until it receives confirmation from the receiver, and then sends the next frame. Okay, so basically here it is sending, and then it is stopping. Then again it is sending. So it is the protocol's name has become a stop and wait. So now communication flow or the diagram we will be seeing is the sender will send a frame. Okay, the receiver needs to send a acknowledgement. So the receiver send an acknowledgement. As soon as the sender receives the acknowledgement, the sender will send another frame. Then again for this frame, the receiver will give an acknowledgement. And then, so as you notice, just notice this again, once a frame is received, as soon as the sender sends the acknowledgement, the sender will send the next frame. So as soon as it is being received, the sender is sending the next frame. Then again, as soon as the acknowledgement is received for the previous frame, the sender is sending the next frame. So this way, the stop and wait protocol works. So here, we add flow control to our previous protocol. So in the case of simplest protocol, we did not have flow control. That is, the sender was not stopping for some time and then sending the frame. It was continuously sending. Now, we have added a mechanism of flow control to our previous protocol. So flow control is basically you are making sure that the sender receives the frame, processes it, and then sends an acknowledgement so that you can move further. So this is the concept of stop and wait protocol. So at any time, there is one data frame on the forward channel. So this is the forward channel, that is from the sender to the receiver. And then there is one acknowledgement frame on the receiver, reverse channel or the backward channel. So there is a forward channel and a backward channel. So we therefore need a half duplex link. Okay. So now, in the case of protocols, once again, there's the simplest protocol which simply sends the frame. And there is the stop and wait protocol, which sends the frame, waits for an acknowledgement, then again sends the frame, waits for an acknowledgement. Now, in this, the stop and wait protocol, we will have to see the disadvantages of stop and wait protocol. Why? Because why do we need to improve it further? Why do we need the next protocol, which is stop and wait ARQ, automatic repeat request? Now, before we see what happened, what are the advantages of stop and wait, disadvantages of stop and wait protocol, we have to see what happens at the sender side and the receiver side. So we know what is happening by looking at the flow diagram. So we'll just define it. So first and foremost, on the sender side, what happens is the sender should send one data at a time. So one data packet or one frame at a time, it should send. Sender must send one frame at a time. Now, let me just write send over here. Send one frame at a time. What is the next thing it should do? It should send the next packet only after receiving the acknowledgement of the previous packet. So once it receives the acknowledgement, then only it is sending the next frame. So send the next frame, not packet, we are talking about frame. So we will just write frame. So here in the case of send the next frame only after the acknowledgement of previous frame. So this is what happens on the sender side. Now, what should happen on the receiver side? On the receiver side, first and foremost, the receiver must receive and process. That is, it should pass it to the network layer and process the frame. It should receive the frame and process the frame. The next thing is, after the processing, the receiver needs to send an acknowledgement. Send acknowledgement for the frame. So this process of sending the acknowledgement for your previous frame is basically the concept of flow control. So this is actually flow control. You are controlling the flow by sending the acknowledgement and saying that now I can receive the next packet. So now, as I said, we have to see the disadvantages of the stop and wait protocol. So here, let me just write it clearly over here. Disadvantages of stop and wait. So there will be basically, this not disadvantages actually, what kind of problems arise if we use stop and wait protocol. So the first problem will be lost data. So if the data is lost, then it is obviously a cause of concern. Then there is the problem of lost acknowledgement. That is, the receiver is sending the acknowledgement and that is lost on the way. And the third is delayed data or acknowledgement. Delayed data or acknowledgement. Now, what are these three problems? So the first problem, lost data. So suppose the sender is waiting for an acknowledgement for an infinite amount of time and receiver waits for the data for an infinite amount of time. So here in the case of lost data, obviously who is receiving the data? The sender, receiver is receiving the data. So let's see here in this case in our diagram. So suppose the sender has sent this frame, acknowledgement has arrived, and the sender is sending the second frame and it has been lost. Now, on the receiver side, the receiver is waiting for that frame, although it has been lost. So what will happen? The receiver will wait for an infinite amount of time. It may be waiting for the frame to be received, but the frame has been lost. Now the sender does not know that the frame has been lost. Neither can the receiver convey the same. So the receiver cannot send a message to the sender that the frame has been lost. Similarly, in the case of acknowledgement, that is lost acknowledgement, what will happen is lost acknowledgement is similar to the lost data case. In this case, the sender will be waiting for the acknowledgement while the receiver has sent it already and it does not know that the acknowledgement is lost. Now, another scenario is where we have delayed data and delayed acknowledgement. Now, suppose in this case, in the diagram that we have seen earlier, so the sender has sent a frame and it has received acknowledgement. And now again, after sending another frame, so the sender has received sent another frame and it does not receive an acknowledgement for a long time. Then what will it do? It will keep on waiting and then it may send another frame. So what will happen if the frame is delayed or if the acknowledgement is delayed, both of them, that is either delayed frame or delayed acknowledgement, then what will happen is delayed frame or delayed acknowledgement will result in the data being delayed. So data being delayed, and in that case, the sender might send multiple frames at a time. So this will result in a disadvantage, or this will result in an error. So that is the reason the stop and wait protocol is considered. This noiseless channel protocols are considered as protocols which are for ideal scenarios or perfect scenarios, and these are not applicable in the real life. So stop and wait protocol has given us an idea of how to add flow control. So we have seen that stop and wait protocol uses the concept of flow control, but not error control. So now, obviously, whenever we are talking about real networks, then it will be a noisy channel, not noiseless channel. So when we are talking about noisy channels, so we need both the control mechanisms, that is flow control and error control. So for both these mechanisms to exist, we need a different protocol. So now we will be seeing the protocols of the noisy channels. So here for noisy channels, we will be discussing three protocols. So let's see the three protocols of noisy channels. So we discuss three protocols in this section that use error control. So obviously, whenever we are talking about noisy channel, we need the concept of error control. So for error control, the three protocols which use both flow control and error control are stop and wait ARQ. This automatic repeat request is also given the abbreviation of ARQ. So automatic repeat request. And I'll be using the term ARQ mostly, so just remember this. So we have stop and wait ARQ, then we have go back and ARQ, and then selective repeat ARQ. These are the three protocols of noisy channels which will use both flow control and error control. And now you will understand why I have again revised the stop and wait protocol. And one more thing, these protocols are very, very important and will be asked in the examination. So now, error correction in stop and wait ARQ is done by keeping a copy of the sent frame and retransmitting of the frame when the timer expires. So now, before understanding this statement, we have to understand what happens when you are sending the frames. As I said in the earlier topic of stop and wait protocol, that we will have three problems when you're dealing with only flow control. So the three problems, as I said, were lost acknowledgement, lost data, or delayed acknowledgement or data. So here, in the case of this stop and wait ARQ, it adds a simple error control mechanism. So here, to the stop and wait protocol, we are adding error control mechanism. Now, what is this error control mechanism and how will it? Now, what do you mean by error control first? Error control means two things. First is detection of errors. And the second is, obviously, once you have detected, you have to correct the errors. So correction of errors. So stop and wait ARQ does two things. First is the detection and second is the correction. So now to detect and correct the frames, either corrupted frames or lost frames, what will happen? So one more thing we know is there are two kind of frames. One is the corrupted frames, that is, it might have some kind of error in it, or there we may have another is lost frame. So these are the two types of errors we might have. So for corrupted frames, what should happen? We need to add something known as redundant bits. We have seen this redundancy, cyclic redundancy check topic. So we need to add redundant bits for the for any kind of frame that we are sending, we will add redundant bits. Now, whenever the receiver receives bit, it will check these redundant bits to verify whether your frame is corrupted or not. So once it has checked whether the frame is correct or not, when the frame arrives at the receiver site, it is checked. And once it is checked, so just let me write it, what happens at the receiver site? It is checked. If it is correct, it will be passed on to. So when it is checked, there will be two things, correct, yes or no. If yes, passed on to the network layer. If no, what will happen? If no, it will simply be discarded. So once it is discarded, then it needs the frame again. That is, the frame needs to be sent again. So the detection of errors is basically whenever it needs the frame again, it won't send an acknowledgement. Okay, so if the frame is corrupted, no acknowledgement is sent. Okay, no acknowledgement is sent means the sender will obviously wait for the acknowledgement. If it has not received an acknowledgement, it will retransmit the frame. So basically, for both, for the detection, we are using this concept redundancy. For the correction, we will be using the retransmission. Retransmission of frame. And obviously, whenever the frame is lost, even then the receiver won't send an acknowledgement. Then also the sender will retransmit the frames. So these are the two things that will happen. So lost frames are basically more difficult than corrupted ones. So the receiver received frame. The receiver, what it will do is whenever it does not receive anything and it won't give back an acknowledgement, then the sender will retransmit the frame. So this is the concept of error control mechanism in your stop and wait ARQ. Now let's go back. So error correction in stop and wait ARQ is done by, now how will the sender retransmit the frame? It will keep a copy of the sent frame. So it will keep a copy of this frame and retransmit, and it will also keep a timer. So there are two things here it will do extra than your earlier protocol. What are the two things that it will do? First, whenever it is sending a frame, it will save a copy of the sent frame, and it will also maintain a timer. Okay, so how does it keep the copy? It saves the copy on the sender side, and also it will put a timer. Now the corrupted and lost frames are resent in this stop and wait protocol. So if the receiver does not respond when there is an error, then how can the sender know which frame to resend? So basically the sender keeps a copy of the frame. At the same time, it will start a timer. Now once the timer has expired, so maybe the timer that you keep on your phones, so you can just understand this by, let's take an example, the timer is of 2 minutes. So the sender will wait for 2 minutes for an acknowledgement to come. So if there is no acknowledgement of the frame that you have sent, then what will happen? The frame is resent. So this copy is sent again, and again the sender will keep a copy. So there might be multiple copies on the sender side, that is true. But until and unless the acknowledgement is received, the sender will keep on making copies and sending it to the receiver. So since this protocol uses the stop and wait mechanism, and there is only one specific frame that needs an acknowledgement, there might be several copies of the frame in the network. Okay, so this is the first point. And I hope you have understood it. Now we will move on to the next thing in this protocol. So in stop and wait ARQ, now whenever you're transmitting the frames and getting the acknowledgement, there might be multiple frames and there might be multiple acknowledgement. Now which frame is sent and which acknowledgement is received, to keep a track of all that, we use something known as sequence number. Okay, so basically we are giving a sequence to the frames and also we are giving a sequence to the acknowledgements too. So both the frames and acknowledgements are receiving some kind of sequence number. Now what is the sequence number? Do we use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? No, we are using the sequence numbers based on modulo 2 arithmetic. This we have studied in the earlier class if you remember. So basically we will be using zeros and ones to sequence our frame. Okay, now the next thing will be, so basically whenever we are talking about a frame, the frame will hold the data. So first and foremost, obviously it will have the data, and to check the data it will have something known as redundancy bits. Okay, it will have redundancy bits, then it will also have a sequence number. Both the frame and the acknowledgement, the frame will have data, redundancy bits and sequence numbers. Acknowledgement will have the redundancy bits and the sequence number both. So a field is added to the data frame to hold the sequence number of that frame. And one important, why are we using the modulo 2 arithmetic? Why are we using only zeros and one? Because already data size will be around some bits or bytes, and then we are adding redundancy bits. So now we need to minimize the size of the frame. We can't send frames of kilobytes and gigabytes, right? So to minimize the size of the frame, we have to use the sequence numbers whose range or whose size should be very small. So we have to look for the smallest range. So now we can use the sequence number from 0 to 2 power m minus 1 if the field is m bits long. Okay, so if the size of the field or size of the sequence number storage is m bits, then we can use 0 to 2 power m minus 1, right? But suppose, obviously, we always want to decrease the size of the frame. For that reason, we will be using zeros and one. Now, one more thing we will see is the range of the sequence numbers. What should be the range of the sequence numbers? So I will just go a bit detail in this. Suppose we have X as a sequence number. We have X as a sequence number. Okay. Now, if X is 0, then I only need X plus 1, that is 0 and 1. Why don't we need X plus 2, or why don't we need the sequence number 2? To just understand this, we will take a scenario. Suppose the sender has sent the frame X. Okay. Now, whenever the sender has sent the frame X, three things will happen, or three things can occur. What are the three things that can occur? The first one, or I'll just write A. So the first scenario is the frame arrives at the receiver safe and sound. The receiver sends an acknowledgement, and the acknowledgement arrives at the sender side. So basically, here receiver is receiving the X. Receiver has received X. Let me write that. Received X. And it has also sent an acknowledgement is sent back. Now what will happen? The sender needs to send X plus 1, correct? The sender will send X plus 1. What is the second scenario? The second scenario is the frame has X, a receiver receives the frame X, okay? But the acknowledgement which the receiver sent is corrupted. So acknowledgement, here the acknowledgement is received and it is asking for X plus 1. But here the acknowledgement is either corrupted or lost. Now in that case, what will happen after the timer ends? The sender will resend the frame X after the timeout. So this is after timeout. Now here this X frame is duplicate, and the receiver can recognize because it was expecting X plus 1. Receiver received X and it also sent an acknowledgement, but this acknowledgement was lost and it was expecting X plus 1. The sender sent again the frame X. So it will obviously discard it and it will send an acknowledgement for the same frame, understanding that the acknowledgement is lost. Now, what is the third scenario, the C bit? The frame which the sender sent is corrupted and it is not received at the receiver side. So X is not received. Then what will happen? The timer will time out again. After the timeout, again the sender will send X. So now if you notice in these three scenarios, we understand that we need X and X plus 1. We do not need X plus 2. So hence, we will be using the modulo 2 arithmetic. So let's just go back over here again. In the stop and wait ARQ, we use sequence numbers to number the frames, and the sequence number is based on the modulo 2 arithmetic. I have given an explanation in detail for why we are using this modulo 2 arithmetic. Now, after that, after the sequence numbers, we also need acknowledgement numbers. That is, your acknowledgement also needs to have some kind of numbering. So for that, in stop and wait ARQ, the acknowledgement number always announces in modulo 2 arithmetic the sequence number of the next frame expected. Now, what does this mean? So since the sequence number must be suitable for both the data frames and the acknowledgement frames, what do we do in this is basically the acknowledgement numbers. Suppose if we are sending the frame 0, okay, 0 is being sent. So sender sends the frame 0, receiver will receive the frame 0. Next, receiver will give the acknowledgement back as I need the frame 1. So this is your frame, 0 is the frame, 1 is the acknowledgement. So always the receiver in the stop and wait ARQ protocol will forward the acknowledgement of the next frame. So for example, if frame 0 has arrived safe and sound, the receiver sends an acknowledgement frame with acknowledgement 1. Now, if the frame 1 has arrived, then the receiver will send the frame with acknowledgement 0. So if here in this case, the sender will send 1, then again, it will ask for the next frame 0. So basically, if we have 10 frames, the first frame will be 0, the next frame will be 1, then again 0, 1, and in this way. So 0, 1, 0, 1, the frames will be named. So now we have seen three things with respect to stop and wait protocol. So stop and wait protocol, I'll just summarize it again. Stop and wait protocol will keep a copy of the sent frame. It will keep a copy of the sent frame. Just a minute. And it will keep a timer so that it knows whenever the timer has timed out, it has to resend the frame, this copy. Then it will keep a sequence number to number the frame. We have something known as sequence number to number the frame. And this sequence number is based on the concept of modulo 2 arithmetic. Okay. Then finally, we have acknowledgement number also. It is similar to sequence number to number the acknowledgement. So we have acknowledgement number to number the acknowledgement, that is the number of the next frame expected. Now, what is the next thing? Here, you will see the design of your stop and wait ARQ protocol. Let me just zoom in. Yes. So basically, in this figure, if you see, we have the sending, this is the sender side. And on the sender side, here, we have a sequence number. And in the data frame, we have the concept of sequence number. That is, it is using a field known as sequence number. And acknowledgement frame is using the acknowledgement number. And also, this SN is the control variable, and it keeps a track of which is the next frame to be sent. The sender will get data from the network layer. It will give it to the data link layer. The data link layer will enclose it in the form of a frame. It will add a sequence number, the redundancy bits, and it will pass it on to the physical layer. physical layer will send the frame. This is the forward channel. It is sending the frame. The blue is the data frame. Okay, so it will send the data, and again here it is processed, and on the receiver side it will keep a control variable, which is RN, that is which frame it should receive next. Okay, then this number is passed as the acknowledgement number. Zero will be passed as the acknowledgement number. Here it will pass on the acknowledgement number. This will be received and this will keep on continuing. So basically, what is the events that are happening on the sender side? It will request from network layer and that you need to send the data. Once it is sending the data, it will keep a timer and also it will keep a copy of the frame here. And also whenever it receives the frame, it will be notified by the physical layer. In this case, on the receiver side, it will be notified from the physical layer that you have received the frame and please deliver it to the network layer. Okay, so this is the design for stop and wait ARQ. Now the next is, what are we doing? Again, let me summarize it. This is a very, very important answer with the next two protocols that we will be studying. So in the stop and wait ARQ protocol, we will be doing error control. That is, whenever we have lost a frame or corrupted a frame, the frame is retransmitted. That is known as by the name automatic repeat request. Now the stop and wait protocol uses a error control mechanism. How does it do? Error correction is done by keeping a copy of the sent frame, and at the same time it starts a timer. If the timer expires and there is no acknowledgement for the sent frame, the frame is resent and the copy is held and the timer is restarted. Now, what are the sequence numbers? We have two kinds. One is for the frames and other is for the acknowledgement. So both for identification purpose, both data frames and acknowledgement frames are numbered by using sequence number. A field is added to the data frame to hold the sequence number of that frame. And we use the concept of modulo 2 arithmetic, that is 0s, 1, 0, 1. This will keep on. So for example, if frame 0 has arrived safe and sound, the receiver sends an acknowledgement frame with acknowledgement 1, meaning frame 1 is expected next. If frame 1 has arrived safe and sound, the receiver sends an acknowledgement frame with acknowledgement 0, meaning frame 0 is expected. So here, the sending device keeps a copy of the last frame transmitted until it receives an acknowledgement for that frame. And a data frame uses sequence number and acknowledgement number. So this is the diagram that we have seen. And we have seen what is SN and RN. Okay. Now, we are seeing an example for the same. So first is, sender is sending the frame 0. So let me just zoom in over here. So here, sender has first started a timer and it has sent the frame 0, and this SN is on the frame which is being sent first. Then here, receiver, once it arrives, it will move the variable RN to 1, that is this frame should be sent next. Okay, and it has sent an acknowledgement that the variable has arrived. So this SN has moved to the variable 1. Now frame 1, so frame 0 is sent and acknowledged. Now we are sending frame 1. So here frame 1, it is lost. So if it is lost, then we start a timer, the timer ends, then we restart the timer and we send the frame 1 again. Once it is resent, again we receive the acknowledgement and you see that the variable SN and RN are moved to the next fields. Then again, frame 0 is sent. So frame 0 is sent to the next frame. So this is frame 1. Let me just write it over here. Yeah. So this is your, since it is in zeros and ones, so let's see how many frames are sent in total. This is frame 1. Then when sender is sending the next frame, it is lost. So this is your frame 1, 2. Then for the frame 3, acknowledgement is lost. when because the acknowledgement is lost, the frame 0 is reset. Here you see frame 0 is reset. So because it is reset, the receiver will understand that, okay, it did not receive the acknowledgement. It will discard this duplicate frame and send the acknowledgement again. Okay, so this is the example. Now, let's see once again. So this is for the request, frame 0 is sent, arrival, acknowledgement. And here we have lost the frame 1. So it is reset again and we are getting the acknowledgement for the next frame, that is acknowledgement 0. That is, please send the next frame 0. And then finally, we have frame 0 we are sending, but the acknowledgement is lost for the next frame and we are resending the frame again. So this is the concept of stop and wait ARQ. Now, here, these are the algorithms. So Sn is equal to 0, that is, we are beginning at the frame 0. Then we are saying that, yes, we can send the frame. So you remember this variable can send, which is true. So while it is true, we wait for the event, that is, whenever the network layer will say request to send, then it will send. So it will get the data, make frame, store the frame. Here in our earlier algorithm, it will make frame, send frame. But here we have to keep a copy. So this is the keep copy. And then next we have to send the frame, start timer. Once we have started the timer, Sn is incremented to the next variable. And we change the scan send to halt. That is, we cannot send until and unless an acknowledgement is received. Now, if the event acknowledgement has arrived, so it will say, check the acknowledgement number and it will check whether it is corrupted or not. It will stop the timer. Whatever copy it has saved, it will purge that frame. Purge is basically deleting the frame, and it will change the scan send variable to true. Here in the next case, again, if suppose the timer has expired, that is, this acknowledgement has not arrived, then again what it will do, it will start the timer again and resend the frame. The same way you can understand the receiver side protocol. So here on the receiver side, Rn is equal to 0, that is, it is expecting frame 0 to arrive. Once it has arrived, it will check if it is corrupted. If corrupted, it will sleep and does not send an acknowledgement. If it is correct, that is, the sequence number is equal to your Rn value, whatever frame it was expecting, it will extract the data, deliver the data, and it will increment this control variable Rn. And it will send the frame, that is acknowledgement, with whatever it is expecting next. So these are the algorithms for receiving side and the sender side for stop and wait ARQ protocol. So in the next class, we will continue with an example for this protocol, and then we will continue with the next protocols. Thank you.